Hi, I'm Barbara Lieberman of Pipe and Thimble Bookstore, and welcome to our panel on historical fiction. I'd like to introduce our panelists. We have Alan Trock, Wanda Pyle, and Mark Fine. And I'd like to start with you, Alan, if you could introduce yourself to our viewers and tell us a little bit about your book as far as the time period and the place.
Hi, my name is Alan Trock, and I'm an attorney. And I have been a fan of Abraham Lincoln since I was 12 or 13 years old when I got my first book as a gift from an aunt. That led to the purchase of many other books about Lincoln and a growing fondness for him as a man, for his political ideals, and for his growth as a politician. I've got almost 100 books at home in my library, and every time I got a new book and I bring it home and I was all excited about starting a new book, my wife would say to me, you know, he dies at the end. I said, why would you spoil it for me? Well, one day I came home after she had suggested that I should write a book on my own about Mr. Lincoln. I came home one day and I said, I have an idea. And I ran it by her, and it sounded like something that could develop into a very interesting story. And basically the book is 36 Hours to Save the President. And it's a story of a man who was an Abraham Lincoln fan, has libraries on Mr. Lincoln, and has visited various sites where Lincoln practiced and grew up in Springfield, Illinois, where he grew professionally and politically, sites in Washington, D.C. And while visiting one of these sites, he is serendipitously transported back to April 13, 1865, where he meets a spirit, as it were, who tells him that he has 36 hours to save the president, and the story goes from there.
Wow. Very interesting. Wanda?
My name is Wanda DeHaven Pyle, and I am a retired, semi-retired teacher and administrator, and I've been interested in writing since I was, of course, a little girl, as most of us started very young, writing stories. I come from a long line of oral tradition in my family. Stories have been passed down through the generations and never written down. And so most of what I write is family saga, and it is based on family stories, going back to the beginning when my family were settlers in the Midwest. And so we start with Windborne, which is my first book, and it was covers a century, three generations of women as they encounter some of the social political changes of the time and try to juggle family life. The next book that I wrote is called The Stone House Legacy. It's based on, I grew up on a farm in Kansas, and the home that I grew up in was a cornerstone on the house said the summer of 1861 was dry. And there was an abandoned cemetery on the property. And the stories around that old house and the cemetery, the abandoned cemetery, formed the basis of the Stone House Legacy. The Steel Canyon Legacy then is the second book in the series, where I take one of the characters from the Stone House, move them forward a decade, and in this case it's the woman as the protagonist, and she is dealing with being a single parent in the 1970s and a woman at the same time. Book three of the series is en route, I would say. It's in process and hopefully will be out in 2018. And Mark?
My name's Mark Fine. I'm a former record executive, allegedly tone deaf, so I had to turn to writing rather than singing. My story and link with historical fiction is interesting. I was very slow to read, very slow to read. So my grandmother in South Africa owned a library, and she was committed to get me down the path of reading. So she'd bribe me with Archie comics and Batman comics and the like, which caused a kind of civil war in my home because my evil stepmother resented these things. Out of my house. Fortunately, they compromised at those. I don't know if you remember them. I think they're called Illustrated Classics or comics with Ivanhoe and Three Musketeers, yes. and Man in the Iron Mask. That was the stimulus of my interest in so-called historical fiction or period pieces. And Grandmother prevailed, because the next thing I was reading, Winds of War by Herman Woke, and anything that Leon Uris wrote way before my time, and made me a very precocious reader. And I love this notion of being entertained and educated at the same time. So it all began with an Archie comic book, is all I want you to know. So hence, my book is about a year in South Africa in 1976. The book's called The Zebra Affair, or when I wrote it was The Zebra Affair, but in America it took on its own accent. And this is the foreign edition, and this is the US edition, but same words inside, but maybe the word color might be C-O-L-O-U-R. And in a book about South Africa, color is very, very important issue, because that's how people were stratified and graded by bureaucrats in terms of their value to society. So the arcana of apartheid and the ugliness of it is very, very difficult. So I introduced two characters, a man from Malawi called Stanwell Marunda, who comes down to work on the South African gold mines, and he has a car accident, and he's saved by a white farmer's daughter called Elsa, and out of it there's this incipient romance that becomes a rather passionate affair, and it's the torrid and difficult circumstances they find themselves, where 7 years worth of imprisonment is the promulgated by law for simply crossing that forbidden color barrier, romantically speaking. And for me, touching on these points many years later from the United States was a fascinating journey.
At your recent event here, you mentioned the definition of historical fiction. And so I wanted to ask each of you, and I'll start with you, Mark, how do you define historical fiction?
I'll give you a slight analogy. I happen to have gone down to the Romance Writers of America's Combine down in Orange County. Wonderful, fascinating how these worlds are created around romantic stories and how various writers contribute, and very impressed. But when it came down to what is a romance book, I was distressed to see that every book had to have a guaranteed happy ending.
Yeah, we were just talking about that earlier.
And that eliminates Romeo and Juliet. That eliminates every Merchant Ivory, great love stories that I know. And that those kind of definitions, which are kind of imposed, limiting our creative expression, the adventure we're going to take our reader on, I think becomes counterproductive.
It's also not real.
It's not real.
And for me, I have an issue, which I brought up earlier. I have a story that I have to define as a historical love story, because romance is defined as having a happily ever after. My problem with that is, what does that look like? Because perhaps the character is so changed by the relationship that even if two people don't end up together, it's a happy ending. So it is very confining.
It's also the characters could have progeny who could go on to productive lives,
right,
or whatever the case might be. So I found this kind of being channeled into this inevitable conclusion is unfortunate. Mm-hmm. So I found the same issue in historical fiction. There is this arbitrary, capricious, it's got to be 50 years old. And I don't know who promulgated that, but I was so perplexed by it, I went to speak to UCLA historical department, if you will. And they do not use 50 years as the criteria. They were far more pragmatic, and they said, an event is consigned to history when the cycle of the incident is completed. So the moment the Berlin Wall came down, that was the end of the USSR, that was the end of communism as we know it. that is now historical. So in South African terms, in 1994, when once prisoner Nelson Mandela became prisoner of South Africa and apartheid was consigned to the trash heap of history, that is hence historical. So my book, set in 1976, is not exactly 50 years. So according to the historical writers of the blah, 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 it's not historical. But to people who really study history, it is totally blue bread.
But the 50 years cutoff is debatable. I've read both sides of the issue. I've also read that historical fiction follows an era, which mine does. So I go 60s, 70s, and the next one is going to be 80s. But there's an era. There's a social, obviously, from the 60s, you have the civil rights era. From the 70s, you have the women's movement. Mm-hmm. From the 80s, there's all sorts of things going on there that define that as an era.
Yeah.
And using that definition, that's why I classify mine as historical fiction, because only this one would go back farther than 50 years, I would think.
But to be also fair, in my book, I do tell 100 years of South African history from the Anglo-Boer War all the way through to, so, but it is interesting that it's almost this all, these strictures, I think, are forcing some interesting work to struggle to find comfortable genres and niches and creates kind of confusion. It's not a Victorian piece or Regency piece or whatever, but it doesn't mean it's not historical.
And I think that we get caught up in genre when the story needs to stand by itself sometimes. Your book is science fiction along with historical fiction.
That's true.
And I think that trying to fit into a genre is maybe not the way it should work. For me, I write a story and then I have to go, okay, what categories does it go in? As opposed to I'm going to write a historical fiction or I'm going to write, I write what comes to me and then I have to kind of fit it into a box in order to put it on Amazon. But for me, it's if it came before me, if it's outside of my time, it's historical.
Yeah.
So if it's I was born in 62, but the 60s doesn't feel like my time because I was so young.
Yeah.
So the 50s to me is historical. And it's outside the 50-year mark. But I think that if you're reading a book and it's before your time, it's going to feel historical. I struggle with some of the rules.
For me, historical fiction that I have read and enjoyed and what I kind of followed in my book is the ability to take a fictional character, put him into a real historical setting, and then make that left turn that didn't occur during the course of true history and go down a different path with that storyline, develop a whole different relationship between the characters, and appear to go toward an ending, which then makes a right turn coming back to get you back onto that historical path. And so it's kind of weaving through history, in and out what really took place, and also balance that with your storytelling of a fictional event based upon a true historical event.
I often believe that's what students should be reading as well, because history is so dry and crusty often the way it's presented. And if it's a way of making it lively and dynamic and relevant, and they will recall and retain the important sort of bones of history in the midst of a fanciful narrative, I think that's very good than shutting, because it's funny when you watch the Jay Leno types interview people on the streets and they know nothing.
Right.
And I think it's because it's always been marketed badly, it's so dull and so dry. I'd much rather, whether it's through a Ken Follett story or whether an alternate history such as yours, people can become at least conversant of those major touch points of a period and be informed by it. And I think it will live in their memories far more vividly.
It immerses you personally. You connect with a character in that time as opposed to dates and times and, the record of the winners, as they say.
Yeah.
And one of the things I was thinking about when I was preparing for this is that historical fiction is kind of like the TARDIS, if you know Doctor Who. It takes you to times and places you couldn't go and immerses you. And if the writer is good at what they do, you know what it smells like. You know what it tastes like. You know what it looks like in a way that you can't know from a textbook. And so I agree. I think it really makes it much more personal and memorable and makes you feel a connection. And when you feel connected to things, you remember them.
I remember in Winds of War, it was because I asked Dad, you know, how did World War II start? I don't know, I was 10 years old or something. And
simple question.
It was a simple question, and
sure.
He reached for this book. And it was fascinating, you know, Herman Woke was masterful because he was able to address all the theaters of the war from behind the concentration camp, you know, barricades to the Pacific to the German side, everything, because Pike Henry's family had in-laws or out-laws or relatives or son in action, or he was on a ship in the Pacific. And through this family as an avatar of sorts, and because you cared about them, it was extraordinary how this complex three-dimensional chess of going on in all these quarters around the globe were covered in this single book. And it has been the basis of all knowledge going forward. Mm-hmm. And somehow I knew I think when it's superbly written, that you can delineate between the fictional characters at the core and the real people
mm-hmm.
they brush shoulders with. And I think it was an extraordinary basis of my knowledge.
I agree that the personal touch is really what makes history come alive. But there are so many subgenres within historical fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And which makes it very hard to define. For example, if you're writing revisionist history,
mm-hmm.
it comes with a slant. And discerning readers need to understand that the slant is there
mm-hmm.
and that you are viewing it through a specific lens.
Fair enough.
And that lens will color, you know, your reaction to it. So I think there needs to be a balance between true history
mm-hmm.
and historical fiction. And readers, I think, are discerning enough to pick that up. Again, one without the other, it's difficult for normal people to just identify with that period if they didn't live it.
Absolutely. Is it possible to write historical fiction without a slant as a writer? Is it possible to?
I'm not sure that it is,
yeah.
because otherwise it wouldn't be fiction.
Right.
And I think going in, you have a predisposed basis for the story.
Mm-hmm.
You know what you want to impart, and it is very, very personal as to what you want to tell to the reader.
And I'm thinking of you and your character.
Right. And exactly. In fact, people who have read the book have said to my wife, Sue, they said, Alex Linwood. That's Alan, isn't it? And she smiles and says yes, because I think you have to put a lot of yourself into it
mm-hmm.
because whatever you're writing, we all have that immense interest and we want to impart. One of the things we want to show in a book, of course, is that you're excited about it and the reader should be excited about it. And your passion translates into the book. And I know with my book, with the other books by the authors, everyone has a passion for that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're imparting, and that is part of what is hopefully going to grasp the reader and make them want to continue with the story.
My motive had several layers to it, but one is I just felt apartheid had been reduced to a bumper sticker. People simply saw black versus white. And South Africa, you know, for a small country, at that time, I think 35 million people, whose motto was unity is strength, the greatest irony of all time. No one understood how truly factionalized all layers of society. So blacks, but they were not homogenous. There are 13 major black tribes, the Zulu, the Venda, the Sotho, the Tswana, all hated each other. So you have this sort of tribalism thing that is why they could not unite against a super minority. But ironically, you had the two white tribes. You had the English speak and the Afrikaner. And the wounds of the Boer War had never ended. And so you think we're a super minority, you should cling together and support one another, eviscerated each other. And so you, so I wanted to people to understand that there were so many, this was so many planes that were fractured all the time. And the rivalries between all these competing things is why for 48 years apartheid existed, because it was enabled by factionalism at all levels. And I feel, and I felt that's a cautionary tale, because it was the Yugoslavian story when Tito died. It's probably issues in the Middle East as well. It's this factionalism that stops things settling down and being resolved. And so, I wanted to take it away from simply this binary black versus white. It was a far more complex issue, which has not been noticed and addressed. And actually, in contemporary South Africa, I think the reason why it's not a success is these factions have now surfaced at the tribal level, not at skin color level, and the same divisions and are perpetuated. It's just not so easy. It's not so apparent.
I think what you're describing is what sets historical fiction apart, is because there's a slant, there is a different perspective. For example, this book is heavily dealing with the civil rights issues, but it's set in Indiana rather than in the South, mm-hmm. where that took place.
Yeah.
And all three of them. What I've done is take historical events or political events that we're all sort of familiar with, like civil rights, like women's lib or whatever, and then set it in a location you wouldn't expect,
nice.
With people
yeah.
you wouldn't expect, so that you see that through a different lens, and a totally different slant from what the newspaper would give you or what a history book would give you.
And I think that, especially in school, history is reduced to facts, figures, and also very reductionist. The cause of the Civil War was the Second World War was the assassination of, you know, I mean, we kind of reduce it and don't get into a lot of these other causations. We don't take the First World War and go into the Second World War. We never talk about the Boer War, at least in the U.S. And so based on what you were saying, how much of the setting then is almost like a character in your story? Do you feel that that becomes a character element in the story as much as the people?
Very much so. It's more than a backdrop, because it colors what the actual events of the story, and it colors the way people react. For example, this is divided into three different books, and the second book deals with World War II,
mm-hmm.
but from a totally different perspective, from a male and a female perspective. So the female during World War II in the United States, especially in the Midwest, didn't really know, most Americans didn't really know what was going on,
right.
and they were isolated from the events of the war. And then you had the soldier on the front line, and what happens when the two of them come together is explosive. And even though they both went through that time period, because they look at it from the different perspective, she was isolated, she was going to UFO dances and, you know, jitterbugging and things like that. He was shooting German aircraft out of the Mediterranean. And then when they come together, they can't relate to each other as well because of the background. So you see that kind of throughout this one, especially. I use both a male and a female perspective, but dealing with the same time period.
Mm-hmm.
And so that becomes more than a backdrop, because it colors how they respond to things.
And in my book, the setting is obviously very, very important. If you've got somebody from present day who's used to present day accommodations and all things that deal with how you live your life, suddenly transported to mid-19th century, where none of that exists, and has to now deal with a totally different lifestyle, with people who have different approaches to how they just perform their daily activities, and he has to interact with these people, learn how to get around, and learn how to deal with what takes place in mid-19th century, and try to fit in as best he can, because the idea is to be non-conspicuous in trying to achieve what he's ultimately trying to achieve.
one thing that surprised you the most, and I'll start with you, Alan, in your research? What was the one thing that you learned in researching your story that surprised you the most?
That the time frame, how meticulous time was when this event took place, and how with Lincoln and meeting with his cabinet and meeting with Grant, how that took place, the interaction between he and Mary Lincoln, that she was a very, very interesting woman, very difficult to live with as far as outside the home goes, but very supportive of Mr. Lincoln within their confines, and just the relationship that developed between these people, how Lincoln relied on others, and the fact that the character who goes back in time has to learn how to deal with those different issues in order to attempt to get into that circle to hopefully attempt to resolve a very, very serious issue.
Did you learn anything you didn't know about John Wilkes Booth?
A little bit. Learned some things about his mannerisms, about his, he was very prompt, and he was very circumspect in things that he did, and also had a very meticulous way of doing things in a very particular order. He did things almost rote from day to day, had a very set schedule that he followed, that the character had to become entwined with. And I didn't realize that that was something that that really dealt with John Wilkes Booth and how he would face his days.
Wanda?
Probably the thing that surprised me most comes out of Windborne. It's semi-autobiographical, and it deals with three generations of women. And what surprised me is how, as I was doing my research, it surprised me to see how women pass on to their daughters certain attitudes and tendencies in relationships. For example, in the very first book, which is based on kind of roughly great, based on my my grandmother, who was a one-room school teacher, and she married a cowboy, literally a cowboy. So we have the school mom and the cowboy.
Yeah.
And I actually author a blog entitled School Moms and Cowboys.
Oh, wow.
Because as I was researching this, I discovered, you know, as we moved into my the next generation, that the characteristics of the cowboy are his supreme independence and his high moral authority and so on. You know, there are certain characteristics of cowboys aside from spurs and cowboy hats. And then there are certain things that are characteristic of educators, school marms, if you will. And we pass that on. I'm an educator. My mother was an educator. My grandmother was an educator. My daughter is an educator. So it has passed through the generations. And then I started looking at relationships and the type of man that we sort of are drawn to is the cowboy personality, and how that and I went, wow, that's really that blew my mind. So that, you know, they're independent, they're strong, they are they respect women, but they are you know, on their own, kind of do their own thing. You know, they don't do well in structured environments where they have to answer to a higher authority. They want to be their own boss. And so we sort of kind of went, oh dear. That's enlightening. Especially since I have 15 grandchildren. I'm looking down the aisle going,
I had two, you know, eureka moments. There was this arrogance of certainly white South Africans, because at the I'm not talking in racial sense, but we were a very sophisticated first world cohort at the tip of that. We had our Odeo Drives equivalent. Mm-hmm. Mercedes had its only other manufacturing plant outside Germany in South Africa. I mean, we were rarely, stunningly first world, and in 45 minutes away the elephants or whatever. I mean, it's quite extraordinary. So we never felt isolated, but how isolated we were. Mm-hmm. And one of the important things in this book, I talk about the introduction of television in 1976. South Africa was the last nation on the planet to get television. We never saw Neil Armstrong walk on the moon. We were, by the government, kept in this bubble. And so if you have state-run media, but you don't really think of it that way because the newspapers are owned by the government and South African Broadcasting Corporation is, and you have censorship and all these things, but it's just, you have nothing because there are no common borders. We just pop over to Brussels and see what's going on. Add in that persona non grata thing as a nation, that to fly to Europe was so complicated because we actually had to fly way over the Atlantic Ocean and stop on a little island to refuel because our planes would get shot down if we went directly across Africa to, we didn't really travel. So what it meant is with the government, so with the hose pipe and choking it off of knowledge, there was no evidence of black excellence. So whites never knew. For example,
there was nothing to counter your
knowledge. So everyone thought the black is destined to be a laborer, and the black felt that, and the white felt that because there's no exceptions. And I talk in the story of how one of the characters goes to Manhattan, and it's August, and it's hot, and it's humid, and he retreats into a movie theater just for the air conditioning. And there's a Sydney Poitier film festival.
Wow.
And he sees guests who came to dinner and in the heat of the night. And he sees this super attractive, erudite, handsome, you know, first world man who happens to just have a different color complexion. And how stunning it was to have this image of blackness that simply did not exist in South Africa. And so Cassius Clay and Muhammad Ali, we would listen to his fights on radio. You would not see him pummel a white man. You know, so there was never, there was no evidence of black excellence. And so part of the story is how media can really burst that bubble and as I say, even within black consciousness, there was no sense that they could assume such greatness. And so that's, so both, they, you know, so
yeah,
that was one big element of it. The other was Afrikaner, you know, these Boer farmers. I always attributed their hatred to the English speaker was they were bad losers. You know, they lost two Boer wars and that's the end of
yeah.
it. And in my research, and I don't know why it was never taught to us,